Hi again. We are on page 11 of The Three Worlds by Nelson Barbour, Charles Taze Russell. Barbour has been talking about the millennial probation in the millennial age. According to statistics then and now, most men have died. And yet, when are they going to be judged fairly, according to the logic of Barbour and Russell? Because the scripture says, "As I live, saith the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, every tongue shall confess to God." Well, if that's in the Old and New Testaments, as a promise from God himself, then they must bow one day. How will this happen? Well, of course, the answer that Barbour and Russell come up with is a distinctive teaching of the Watchtower now. So here he goes. If it be asked, why did not God bring these extinct nations to the knowledge of the truth before they fell asleep, that is, in death, if he ever intended to do so, I answer, God having arranged that there was to be a second Adam and a second Eve, the wife of the second Adam, and that through this second Adam, all that was lost through the first Adam should be restored, has thus far been doing only a preparatory work. The Jewish nation supposed the promise of God that all the families of the earth should be blessed through the seed of the woman would be fulfilled under the law, while the Christian church have, with as little authority, claimed all for the gospel. If God had satisfied the Jewish nation, much scripture in relation to Gentiles would have remained unfulfilled. If God satisfies the nominal Christian church, much prophecy, irreconcilable with the narrow way, would remain unfulfilled. But he has said that he will be for a stone of stumbling to both the houses of Israel, which I guess we have to presume he means literal Israel and, as he would have seen it, spiritual Israel. The salvation under the law was for a class and not for all mankind. The salvation under the gospel of the kingdom is for a class, the bride, the Lamb's wife. Hence the way is narrow, and the few there be that find it. Hence many are called, and few are chosen. Hence no man cometh unto me, except the Father draw him. But in the kingdom the waters of life will be broad and deep, and there will be the Spirit and the bride saying, Come, and whosoever will, let him take life's water freely. As the marriage of the Lamb and beginning of the restitution of all things follows the second advent, the salvation of the world does not commence until then. Hence Christ says, I pray not for the world, but for them thou hast given me, according to John 17:9, and adds in verse 20, Neither pray I for these, that is the 12 alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. Notice carefully the world, the meaning of the world here. He's praying not for the world, but for his own, his bride, all that will believe through the word of the 12, and they all may be one, that they all may be one with him. They twain become one, and the outcome of this mystical marriage is that the world may believe, and to show that this is the true order, the marriage is placed at the end of the gospel dispensation. The positive proof that there is a chance for the world in the millennial age, after this present dispensation ends, after the second Adam and his wife are joined together, is gathered first from the order of progression given in 1 Corinthians 15 verses 45 to 49. The apostle, be it remembered, is speaking not of the individual, but of the race of Adam. And so it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul, that is, person. The last Adam, a quickening spirit. Howbeit, was not the first which is spiritual, but that which is natural or animal, and afterwards that which is spiritual. The first man is of the earth, earthy. The second man is the Lord from heaven. And as we have borne the image of the earthy, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. The apostle's reasoning is that the first stage of this progressive development of the human family is to bear the image of the first man, male and female, for they were one flesh, after which they are to bear the image of the second man, who also has a wife, who becomes one with him. And to suppose the apostle is speaking of only the second man and his wife, simply the bride of Christ, is just as absurd as to suppose when speaking of the first Adam, he meant only the individual pair. He is showing that the earthy animal man precedes the heavenly spiritual man as God's true order, and therefore the work of the first man precedes that of the second man. And God does not perfect separate individuals, but works by dispensations. While under the Jewish dispensation, not a Gentile could be saved, and even the Jew could not be made perfect without us, according to Hebrews. Hence, David hath not ascended into the heavens, according to Acts 2:34, nor has any man. No man hath ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man, which is in heaven. John 3:13. And the second Adam does not begin the regeneration of the children of the kingdom until the marriage of the Lamb, when his wife hath made herself ready. As the natural or animal man has multiplied and replenished the earth, so also in the regeneration, when the Son of Man shall sit on the throne of his glory, will he multiply and replenish the earth with a spiritual family. And a nation shall be born in a day. And the evidence is conclusive that when he sits on the throne of his glory, when the kingdom is the Lord's and he is the governor among the nations, all the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all kindreds of the nations shall come and worship before thee. But it is only when he comes in his glory and during the sounding of the seventh trump that the kingdoms of the world become the kingdoms of our Lord, according to Revelation 11, verse 15. And he thus becomes the governor among the nations. Hence it is after the marriage of the Lamb, after this present dispensation is ended, and in the millennial age, or world to come, that the conversion of the world is due. If God has been trying to save the world before the second man and his wife were perfected, in opposition to his own prearranged plan, he has taken a strange way to do it. Why, for more than 2,000 years, did he let the human family go down in death? For death reigned from Adam to Moses, with no effort to bring them to the knowledge of the truth. Why, if he was trying to save the world under the Jewish dispensation, did he make it unlawful to give the children's meat to dogs? Why should Christ command his disciples, "Go not in the way of the Gentiles, and into any city of the Samaritans enter ye not"? They were dying day by day, and if modern ideas be true, were going to hell, to eternal torment. And Christ, who was about to give his life for the world, would not allow the bread of life to be given them, and excused himself by saying, "For I am sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." If there was to be no restitution, and this life was indeed the end of all hope to the sinner, such apparent indifference to man's eternal interests could not be reconciled with God's professions of love to the world. All men, every man that cometh into the world, etc. Not a Gentile saved, or even an effort in that direction, until a prearranged and definite point of time had arrived. And yet God, no respecter of persons, and when the fullness of time had come, God sent his Son forth into the world, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law. And until the day of Pentecost, he made no provision for any other class. He did not come at his first advent to save the world, for he was sent only to those under the law. He did not even pray for the world. "I pray not for the world," John 17, verse 9. He took upon him our nature, that he might taste death for every man, and gave himself a ransom for all, to be testified in due time. That 1 Timothy 2, verse 6. And this due time is after his second advent and during the millennial age, which, of course, we've seen already is timed. The millennium, according to Barbour and Russell, has already begun in the 1870s, and the due time for his turning his attention to the world is after 1914. Well, next time, what is our hope if we are part of this anointed group? We become part of the Godhead